What is the worst MCU film? I recently put that question out on Twitter, and overwhelmingly, the response was... not Iron Man 2. Like, I was kind of hoping in this intro I could show with these responses that Iron Man 2 isn't very well regarded, but you guys managed to name just about every other MCU film that isn't Iron Man 2. That's fine, it's cool. But I still want to talk about Iron Man 2. I remember Iron Man 2 as one of the first MCU films I ever saw. In fact, I'm pretty sure I saw it before I saw Iron Man 1. And when I saw it as a pretty young kid, I thought it was awesome. Then, as I grew up and was learning more about the MCU and movies in general and heard everyone's criticisms of it, I focused more in on the film's flaws and didn't want to be biased towards it just because I liked it when I was younger, which ironically kind of led to me being biased against it. And so for many years, I've stuck with the popular opinion that Iron Man 2 is one of the worst MCU films. But recently, I decided to rewatch it with fresh eyes and a more open mind, and I'm here to say, it's not that bad at all. In fact, I'd argue it's a pretty good film. Yes, it does have quite a few less than amazing elements in it, and no, it isn't as good as the first film, but I'm here today to go through the film and discuss why I don't think Iron Man 2 is that bad. I do want this to be a balanced review though, so up front, let's get the bad stuff out of the way, because while I do like this film, I'm not gonna sit here and act like it's perfect. For one, it has too much going on, too many plot threads and characters. You've got Ivan Vanko wanting revenge on Tony because of their dad's issues, Justin Hammer wanting revenge on Tony because he's less successful than him, Tony and Pepper's relationship, Tony and Rhodey's friendship, the government wanting Tony's suits, Tony's arc reactor problems, Tony dealing with his problems regarding his father, S.H.I.E.L.D. wanting to keep an eye on Tony, which leads to Natasha being introduced, and you get the picture. And as we'll get to, most of these plot lines are actually quite interesting, but they don't work that naturally as a cohesive whole. It's like you've got a bunch of bricks for building a wall, and they're mostly solid quality bricks, but they're all different sizes. The wall is probably going to be a little bit wonky. Some of these plot lines do connect in satisfying ways, some of them connect in questionable ways, and some just don't connect that much at all and kind of feel like they're from different films, which is sometimes why the movie can feel a bit messy. Because the movie's got so much going on, it often doesn't have that much time to explore some interesting ideas, like Rhodey being Tony's friend, but also having to be loyal to the government. We only really scratch the surface of some of those interesting concepts. I'm also not a huge fan of how S.H.I.E.L.D. turns up in this film and just kicks Tony back into gear. Like, it's not a terrible way to do it, but I kinda wish there was more of Tony kind of struggling to get back himself, which they have a bit of in him synthesizing the new element, which also I do enjoy him using his intelligence once again to get out of a problem. But he's been pretty awful to most of the people in his life, he's hit rock bottom, and instead of having some kind of realization about changing his ways then, rather than later in the film as he does, he's given everything he needs to keep going by S.H.I.E.L.D. Not the worst way to do it, but it feels a little odd in the story. Also, Nick Fury just kind of shows up, which given that we know him quite well as a character now, might not seem as weird, but this was his first appearance in the MCU after that tiny cameo at the end of Iron Man, and he kind of just shows up and helps Tony out. Yes, Tony himself does synthesize the element, but it sort of feels like the writers didn't know how to bridge the gap between these parts of the film, and were just like, hey, here's Nick Fury with an Avengers tie-in as well. Feels a little unnatural narratively, despite how much I like Sam Jackson in this film. The plot contrivance of Howard's life work being this one element is an odd plot device, which again feels like they needed these two plot points together, and so it ends up feeling kind of too contrived that this element is exactly what he needs. And once he synthesizes the element, it doesn't feel that satisfying in the film as much as it feels like, okay, that's that plotline done, we can check that off the list. And then the one thing about this film that is sometimes the best part of it, and at other times the most obnoxious, is the character of Tony Stark. I'll talk about the good aspects of that character in a bit. Hold your horses. I know this video is about why Iron Man 2 isn't that bad, and mostly I've just talked about the negative so far. We're getting to the positive, alright? I promise. But as far as the bad aspects of him, he is incredibly unlikable for a lot of this film. Tony Stark as a character can be unlikable. He's a dick. But most of the time, the filmmakers and Robert Downey Jr. are able to walk that line, where he's charming and fun to watch and a good person, and so his more snarky moments add to the charm and are part of the fun of the character. In this, he's just genuinely annoying a lot of the time, and there are times where he's meant to be annoying, but there are other points where clearly it's supposed to be like, oh, look how cool this guy is. But really, he comes across more as a guy you want to punch in the face. When people were saying that they loved seeing Tony get beat up in Civil War, I didn't really get it, because again, yeah, he's a bit of a douchebag, but that's more balanced by his charm and his good traits. But after watching this again, I really do get it. And I may or may not have then rewatched that Civil War clip a few times. Ah, good stuff. There's a line between fun and just obnoxious, and unfortunately, this movie's version of Tony Stark falls over that line at a few points. At points when it's not entirely intentional as well, because I know sometimes it is part of the plot. I also feel that this movie, especially at the start, walks back Tony's arc from the first film of becoming a little more humble or learning a bit of a lesson. Like, yeah, he's still super cocky and Tony Starkish, but he's not as annoying as he is at the start of this film. This does work for this multi-movie arc he goes through, because even though he learned some lessons from that first film, he still has a ton of stuff to learn and grow from, and so in that sense, this 11-year arc works pretty well. If you look at these two films together, though, it is kind of odd. But hey, since they pulled it off by the end, I guess this specific part isn't that much of a complaint. And really, I think now I can transition into talking about the good with this film, starting with the good aspects of Tony Stark as a character. And I want to clarify here, I really do like this character. Even though in this film he can be unlikable at times, I think in other films he's generally more likable and a really, really interesting character. There's a lot to explore with this character, and I really love how we've seen that exploration and development of this guy as a person over the course of the MCU films. But I'm getting a bit off topic. The stuff that makes Tony Stark likable and a great character is still present in this film. For one, the Robert Downey Jr. performance is great as always. He's very charismatic, he's charming, and you have to be very charming to keep the audience rooting for a character, most of the time, that can be very unpleasant. I'm saying those unlikable parts would be way, way worse with a lesser actor in this role, or an actor who doesn't fit this character so well. So when Tony's incredibly unpleasant, Downey makes it bearable. And other times, Downey makes this character so charming and so much fun to watch, because this character, even in his very cocky moments in this film, does have some moments that you can't help but smile at. When they get that balance right, it's so much fun to watch. And while that's not as present in this film as it is in others, it certainly is still there at times. Tony and Happy have a fun dynamic, even if we don't see that much of it. Tony and Rhodey play off each other really well, more on that later. And Tony and Pepper do have good chemistry, despite Tony being Tony sometimes. The story does also take a nice turn where Tony gets taken down a peg, where by the start of the third act, everyone is just absolutely sick of him. At the times when his annoyingness is actually acknowledged and a part of the story, it is quite satisfying to watch. I do really like, though, the more human moments that Tony gets throughout this, which help develop him into less of an annoying character to watch. The entire story arc with his father is one of the best things about this film, and helps us understand this cocky bastard on a more human level, much like some of the elements of the first film, which I really enjoyed. I also think this movie doesn't get enough credit for its villains, or mostly one villain. Okay, Vanko, not an amazing villain. He has some, not great moments. And he does kind of fall into the more generic MCU villain category, but I don't think he's bad. Visually, the initial Whiplash design especially is quite interesting, although maybe not the most practical. He is intimidating, he has a few memorable moments, with the bird for example, and his motivations revolving around his father and Tony's father, in terms of MCU canon, is pretty interesting. I also quite like the opening scene paralleling Tony making his suit in the cave. It's an intriguing way to start the sequel. However, easily one of my favorite parts of this film is the other villain, Justin Hammer, as played by Sam Rockwell. Honestly, one of my favorite villains in the MCU. You know how I said Tony Stark is annoying at points in this film, but Robert Downey Jr.'s charm is able to make it bearable, and bring it down back to fun after a bit? Well, Justin Hammer is what happens if that wasn't the case. He's the much worse, much less charming, douchier version of Tony Stark, and Sam Rockwell nails that so well, and plays that in such an entertaining way. I want to make it clear, when that annoyingness is done intentionally and carried so well by Rockwell, pun not intended, it's golden. From the way the crowd reacts to him, to his interactions with Tony Stark, which show he's the way smarmier version of him. To the ex-wife scene, which generally is just really well edited and funny anyway, he's a great character. Especially when it's someone to root against and laugh at instead of laugh with, this annoying personality works so brilliantly, mainly because of how it's played by Rockwell. It's just like the Hammer Tech itself, a discount worse version of Stark Tech. I know not a lot of people would put him up there as one of the great MCU villains, but tell me, did Thanos ever do this? Didn't think so. I also really enjoy his team up with Vanko. Vanko clearly just taking advantage of this idiot for his own gain. They play off each other in a great way, which is just helped by Rockwell's great comedic timing.
I can get you a bird, I can get you 10 birds. I want my bird.
Well, okay, nothing's impossible. Are we talking about, is this a bird back in Russia?
And it's also fun to see when he finally loses it on him, and you see Hammer's real, quite childish self, not hidden that well underneath this fake playboy billionaire facade. So yeah, Justin Hammer, hope we get to see him, and also his dance moves again sometime in the future. In terms of other characters, we also get the introduction of an MCU favorite in this film, Natasha Romanoff, which I think is handled actually pretty well, especially when looking at it on its own, and not how it's another plot point which contributes to this film having a bit too much going on. But her introduction into this world is quite well done. Switching on a dime from this assistant who has the dynamic with Tony Stark that, well, you'd expect Tony Stark to have with this kind of character, to this badass assassin, it's a great setup for how easily this character can manipulate people and switch in and out of roles, and really, how good she is at her job. It just seems like another Tuesday to her. And Johansson pulls all of that off really well, both the facade and the real Black Widow. Also pretty great comic accurate Black Widow costume, but we'll talk more about costumes later. Like I mentioned before, even if there are too many of them, and so they aren't explored as much as they otherwise could be, I don't think any of the subplots in this are bad on their own. The Rhodey subplot especially, I find interesting due to that character's conflicting responsibilities. And again, I enjoy when he gets sick of Tony's annoying ways and just beats him up for a bit. Well, technically they beat each other up, really. Also, I enjoy that they're pretty evenly matched in that fight. A drunk expert versus a sober and competent amateur with these suits. They would be comparable in terms of skill level. I also think I like Don Cheadle more as Rhodey than Terrence Howard. I don't think Terrence Howard was bad at all. Personally, I just find this version of Rhodey a little more genuine and likable, and I think that mostly comes down to Cheadle just being such a charismatic actor, which I feel is displayed even more as these films go on. And the whole recast thing, I feel like they almost acknowledge it with this moment where he's like, "It's me, I'm here, deal with it," or whatever.
"Look, it's me, I'm here, deal with it. Let's move on."
Kind of feels like a fourth wall break acknowledging the recasting, but maybe I'm just reading into it. Again, I enjoyed the subplot with Howard Stark. I think Slattery does a great job as this older, more stern version of Tony Stark, with still that Tony Stark charm under the surface. In the brief time we get to see him in this film, he plays the character in a way that you can really understand at least part of how Tony became the man he is today, with his father's mannerisms and also how he acted towards him. It sets up a good arc for this film, with the actual reveal of his father's greatest creation being him, and that compassion for Tony that he wasn't able to show to him while he was alive. And also, another multi-movie arc that includes Civil War and concludes with Endgame. I also enjoyed Coulson again here. As much as he was pretty good in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I gotta say, I like him most in these earlier MCU films, where, although he's in them briefly, he's quite memorable and fun, with being kind of out of his element, but still seeming in control and having a fun dynamic with Tony Stark, and seeing him in this reminded me why it was actually a big deal in these films when he got killed. And then Nick Fury in this, again, besides the fact that he just sort of turns up and it's kind of odd, he is great when he's there. The sort of team leader could be a very cliche, stern, kind of tough, no-nonsense guy, and there is an element of that to Fury, but Sam Jackson brings so much personality to him. Regardless of how maybe contrived the plot device of him kicking Tony's ass into gear may be, in terms of just character, you believe he could do that with the most stubborn man in the world. He doesn't take any of Tony's nonsense and he can match wits with him, and all in all, it's just a really fun performance and character. This does change a bit from film to film, but generally he stays a very interesting and charismatic character, which I think primarily comes down to the performance. Two of the strongest points of this film are the action and the visual effects. I've said it before and I'll say it again, my favorite Iron Man suits are the ones from Iron Man 1 to the Avengers. After that, they start to look a little more fake and CGI-ish, not terrible by any means, but at quite a few points, the way they move and assemble and just looks a bit fake. In this film, they look so real and so heavy. That's the main thing I love about these. They look like they're really there. I think sometimes the newer ones, they might be a bit too smooth or move too smoothly. In these films, I truly believe they're there at all times. And the visual effects in that suitcase armor scene, flawless. The concept is already pretty great, the build-up to it is well done, and the effects are so impressive. There's so much detail here. It feels like they had to build an Iron Man suit in real life just to visualize this. It's really spectacular. And speaking of detail, the sound design is amazing. Just listen. And then just Stark's tech in general, I really love in these first two Iron Man films how, I guess, more grounded it feels. I guess these holograms are a bit ridiculous, but it doesn't seem totally out of the realm of possibility, especially given where we started in the first film and how this world is in general. And just little stuff like hacking into the courtroom TV, part of why it's cool is because it all feels real. Honestly, besides that final Whiplash suit, where it's just kind of Mickey Rourke's head poking out of this giant thing and it looks kind of weird, and yes, that's another element of this that feels like a bit of a repeat of the first film, besides that, I'd say visual effects-wise, this film is really impressive and mostly flawless, and the Whiplash effects before that look great. And the action is pretty fantastic as well, some of the best of MCU Phase 1. Visually, it's well shot and it's well edited, you can tell what's happening and where people are and what they're doing at all times, even in scenes where the screen is quite chaotic. I also enjoy the character moments that pull through in the action, so you remember the people involved in this and why you should care and that this isn't just totally mindless. Like, you get to see Tony's quick thinking before he gets the suitcase armor, showing one part of why it's not just the suit that makes him Iron Man. The finale is also quite fun, with Rhodey not being in control of his armor and talking to Tony, but also still having to try and kill him. And really, in that finale, even if it does get a little Michael Bay-ish at times, what carries it is how real these things feel due to the effects, sound design, and how it's shot. These suits feel fast when you see them zooming by, and again, they feel so heavy because of the visual effects and the sound design. It's a very exciting finale, up until that last part, which, to be fair, has a good resolution with the teamwork and call back to their earlier fight, even if it is kind of convenient that they're in those perfect positions, but whatever. The build-up to the drone fight is also great, the banter with Tony and Rhodey and the slow arrival of all the drones. Does a great job of setting up the tension and then paying it off. Also, besides the Iron Man action, the hand-to-hand stuff with Black Widow is also great. This first proper action scene with her, much like how the rest of the film does a good job of setting up her espionage abilities, sets up her type of combat style really well, the way she goes through these guards with precision and not really any difficulty. The music is also good, the score is solid, although not super memorable, but rewatching this, I also enjoyed returning to the AC/DC that used to be so tied to this character. I hope I'm not making it sound like I hate how Tony Stark is in the more recent films. I don't. I'm just saying I also really enjoy the style that Jon Favreau, Downey Jr., and the writers created initially, which evolved into the similar, but somewhat different character we have today. Or, I guess, had. Oof. The film is well shot and well edited, not just the action scenes, but also the more dialogue-centric scenes are also very well edited. Some funny moments come purely from how part of the film is edited.
Rhodey and I are being honored in Washington, and we need a presenter. See what I can do.
It is my honor to be here today.
And much like the first Iron Man, the dialogue is still sharp, funny, witty, and natural feeling. Don Cheadle has talked about how this film was also somewhat shot without a script, in the same way Jeff Bridges said the first film was, and a lot of the dialogue was improvised, and while story-wise, that can also explain some less than great and not entirely smooth narrative progression, it also leads to the dialogue feeling very natural, and the chemistry between the actors just adds so much to that feeling. It's a really funny movie. Again, Hammer and Tony play off each other especially well. Also, I'm going to talk about MCU tie-ins in a second, and this is kind of related to that. This film is criticized a lot for just being a setup for the Avengers, and while yes, there is an element of that where it feels a bit shoehorned in and makes the film a bit bloated, I don't think it's the worst way to do this kind of setup. Again, it does add something to this film. Fury and Tony are very fun together, Black Widow's introduction is handled pretty well, and I also enjoy that by the end, it isn't a totally typical setup that you'd expect from this. Like normally it'd be, you've proved yourself, you're such a hero, welcome to the team. But at the end of this, Fury's like, yeah, you kinda suck. Like, most of the decisions you've made in the past few days have not been good. You're probably not very reliable. And I don't know, I like the expectation subversion and the realism there. At the end here, I thought I'd just go through some MCU tie-ins that I picked up on. I just found this interesting little speedrun for you, Easter eggs in a way. The 10 rings from Iron Man, Iron Man 3, Ant-Man, and the upcoming Shang-Chi give Ivan Vanko some information about the Grand Prix. Obviously, there's the whole Howard Stark angle, which becomes an entire multi-movie arc. Christine Everhart comes back. Some kind of remake of Cap's shield shows up. The Tesseract is in Howard's notebook. I Don't Like People Handing Me Things comes back in the Avengers.
I don't like people handing me things. If you just drop that there, that's right.
As soon as possible.
I don't like being handed
That's
things.
That's fine, because I love to be handed things, so let's trade. Thank you.
Coulson goes to New Mexico, which ties into that one shot, and Thor, as does the post-credit scene, in a slightly more obvious way. Wakanda and Atlantis are on that map in the background, and that's Peter Parker right there, which, as a little retcon, I think is a fun detail and doesn't take anything away from the characters. If anything, it adds more to the character trait of Peter really looking up to Tony. So, in conclusion, I hope you now understand why I think Iron Man 2 is a pretty good film, which I guess isn't as controversial of an opinion as I initially thought, but I still wanted to talk about it. It's a fun movie, and it's far less bland than what I would truly consider the MCU's weaker entries. But hey, we'll get to those some other day. I kinda wanna make this a series where I go in-depth on the MCU films, and really just kinda wanna make more in-depth videos on certain films in general. I don't know, I'll figure it out as I go, but I enjoyed making this. With all that being said, I hope you enjoyed this video. Let me know all of your thoughts on the video or Iron Man 2 in the comments down below. And while you're at it, be sure to like this video, check out my Instagram and Twitter at @BHL_Hudson, and subscribe for more videos like the one you just watched. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.